My brain works in a very non-linear way, so this is going to be a bit chaotic. I am also far off from my comfort zone, but we do have those beautiful images by artist Samantha Hookway. And this first image illustrates the basement and the attic. I spent a lot of time in the basement and the attic when I was a kid, because you could really, those are places where imagination runs wild. And I used to look for material in the basement. I found textiles, I designed my own clothes. I found paint, old paint buckets. And I painted my childhood room walls with hieroglyphs and pyramids. And my first academic degree was in archaeology. And archaeology is a science where you really need to use your imagination. Sometimes you only see this black or darker spot in the soil, and that soil can illustrate an entire longhouse. But learning wasn't always that exciting. Learning is still very standardized. We have a school system that treats people like machines sometimes. We are the school system really doesn't understand our various ways of our cognitive skills. People work very differently in their learning processes. So this is Yggdrasil. Yggdrasil is from the Nordic mythology. It's a nonlinear story, and the story world has it's nonlinear, and it has held through war, it has held through religious oppression, it has held through a long time, and you can even today experience this in games like World of Warcraft and films like Lord of the Rings. So storytelling and game mechanics have been used for a long time to entertain, to learn. And there is even this theory about Stone Age cinema, because some of you might have heard about the transmedia, cross-media interaction and so on. And it's kind of a buzz in the media industry. But it has been around for a long time. And this theory is that if you lit cave paintings with a light, the images are almost like 3D. So there was a theory about Stone Age cinema, like this. And if you combine the Stone Age cinema with the rituals like dancing and playing a game, live action role play, in this kind of labyrinth. A labyrinth is also a very common artifact or structure in the Nordic countries. You already have multi-platform storytelling and even user-generated content. So those are methods I use, and it's natural for us to learn by playing and using game mechanics. And we also do power play. This is Egyptian game Senet and a Nordic game called The King's Table. So those are two of my favorite game characters from the 80s, Bub and Bob. And I try to use play-centric and human-centric designs in all my work with the labs. I use purposeful storytelling and DIY philosophy to kind of work with social issues. But it's really hard to work in this way today because there is no structure, there is no business models that are really fit to this. So being an entrepreneur is like being shut up to space, and you have to build the spaceship on the way, you have to find the fuel, and you have to be able to land. So, and this is kind of hard when you're a misfit in the current system. When you work this way, you work a lot with social capital and knowledge capital. And it's kind of complicated because there is so much work to be done. So I don't really believe in unemployment. There is no such thing as unemployment because there is so much to do in this world. The problem is that there is so much work without pay, like monetary pay. And we can't really pay our bills or our rent with social capital, knowledge capital, so we need new business models, we need new economies. So that is also what I work with. And I have this favorite scientist called Buckminster Fuller, and he once said that you never change things by fighting this existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. So that is something I really believe in. And Bucky, as I call him, talked a lot about synergetics, and he also studied nature and patterns in nature. And what nature and what our planet can tell us is that if we collaborate and if we share resources, we can be as strong as this pillar basalt and this hexagon structure, similar to the graphene we heard about before. It's very strong, and all the pillars support each other, and that is why those can be like many meters high. If you've been to Iceland, you've probably seen those structures. So I try to use this thinking to build sustainable ecosystems where different cognitive skills are valued, and where I create, or we can create, an environment for synapses. Because innovation processes are very similar to neural communication, neural processes. So it's important to create spaces for serendipity and synapses and cross-pollination of ideas. And I believe that we have to do those spaces. They have to be cross-generational, because in Sweden we are very discriminative when it comes to age. We have to have different ages meeting and working in the same spaces. And we also need to share knowledge between those perspectives, and also be transdisciplinary and come from a different background and mix different perspectives. And in the cross-section of those perspectives, we will find innovation and we will find solutions to different problems. So we need to bring in the DIY philosophy into our daily lives. We need to build makerspaces, think about hacker philosophies, use game mechanics and storytelling in our daily lives, and think about human-centric design, or place-centric and human-centered design, and interaction design, and use interaction and narrative design principles everywhere. Like, every organization needs to have an interaction designer in their team, in the same way you have an economical administrator. You need to have an interaction designer. It's a natural part of an ecosystem. And I believe in something that I call the cogwheel philosophy. And the cogwheel philosophy means that you can have a lot of cogwheels, a lot of people, a lot of skills. And compared to a puzzle, for example, the cogwheels can be separated, put together again, and transformed into a flexible machine that you can reassemble and change as many times as you want until you adapt to change in this way. And every wheel is very important, so every person in your team has to kind of know that they can affect the entire context. So the cogwheel philosophy is my favorite philosophy. And we need to bring the basement and the attic into the office. We need to bring the sandbox into the office. We need to bring any workshop from the basement into our living room, maybe instead of watching TV or something. And here's another quote by Bucky. "We are called to be the architects of the future, not its victims." That is the philosophy I want you to bring into the lab out here afterwards. And remember that only imagination is our limit.